Well, Coach, thank you so much for joining me on this episode. It is an honor to have you, fella.
Oh, it's I appreciate you letting me come back and talk, and it's always a lot of fun.
Well, this past summer, you stood on the field after the last pitch of the College World Series. Every dream, every program wants to get to Omaha, but you were the last team standing in Omaha as you watched your kids dogpile. What was the thoughts and what were the feelings that went through you when that happened?
You know, it's pretty surreal. And I've said that to a lot of people. It's been a dream of mine since I was a young kid. It was more as a player, you know, when you're a young kid and then you become a coach and it becomes your dream. And, you know, I'd always stay on and watch the no matter what type of game, tight score, big score, I always want to watch the end, even in any sport. I like to watch the dog pile. I like to watch the celebration. I like to hear what the kids have to say. And so I've always been into that, and to be able to do that and win your last game and hug your kids on the field afterwards and hug your coaches. And, you know, even for me going into the last game, they always ask me, Coach, what uniform are we going to wear? And my dream had always been, you know, since we've been at Mississippi State, we were dogpiling in the Maroons, you know. And so it was kind of one of those things you had foreseen and you hope you always get to, but we just kind of always, you know. So it was Maroons. We're wearing the Maroons tonight. And luckily we were able to play good enough and come out on top.
You know, getting there isn't easy. I mean, you look back at it and you're like, man, if this break didn't go our way, or if that ball didn't bounce this way, or that pitch had been called one way or another, when you pull back from the season, what was different about this year than other years where you may have had a more talented squad or a better team overall? What was the secret sauce of this season?
You know, we had a real resilient team, and I tell everybody that, you know, people at Mississippi State will say, you know, some teams were more talented than this team, but this team was mentally tough and very resilient. We had some big blows we had to take during the year. I mean, we lost, Arkansas came in here and swept us. We're about to have a chance to win the SEC, and Missouri came in and took 2 out of 3 at home against us the second last weekend. And I mean, we were crushed. And then we go to the SEC tourney and we get 10 run ruled twice and get knocked out. And you would have thought the sky was falling in Starkville. And I give our kids credit. They were very resilient, very tough. We got hot. And so that's what you need to be hot. But, you know, through the postseason, we played 3 elimination games. We actually played 4 because we had to play 2 in the championship series. But when you go to the ballpark and you don't know if you're going to put on the uniform again here at Mississippi State, those are hard games to play. And our kids they played their best with the backs against the wall. And I think, you know, we were talented, no doubt, but we also there was a toughness and we could take a punch and we just, you know, take it and get back up and get ready to compete again.
You know, you bring up getting 10 run twice. Leadership is tested, not when you get the win and how you did the press conference. What did you tell your guys after those losses to keep their heads up and to keep their hearts up?
You know, I've learned over the years, because as a young coach, I would have yelled and screamed and, you know, been upset. And the more I do this, you know, we had a saying last year, we give out a game shirt after every game. And going into a COVID year, you know, I really wanted the emphasis to be on the moment. You know, right here, right now was our saying. So all year long, I would say it to them or give them the shirt with it. And that kind of became, you know, COVID, now it's bad again today as we talk, but during the spring, it kind of got to where it wasn't as big of a deal. And it became about all that right here, right now, just became being in the moment and playing that day and that game for us. And, you know, we really leaned on that a lot. And, you know, I think our kids really bought into it. So we talk about we feel like we play in the hardest conference and the hardest division in college baseball. And you're not going 56-0. So you have to, we talk about it. We've already talked about it this year. And we had practice yesterday, our first practice about how tough it is to play in this league and how mentally tough you have to be able to handle the grind of the day in and day out playing against just unbelievable players in this league.
You know, you go back in your playing days, college playing days, we were talking about before we went on, you were at the Citadel. And, yes. You know, we use a phrase all the time at North Star, at the church I pastor, God never wastes our time and he never wastes our experiences. instead of letting the easiest place to be a college baseball player, what shaped you while you played there and you coached for many years there as well? What shaped you to make you who you are today as a coach?
You know, it's funny. I was going to go to the University of Texas and walk on, which I would have probably been an engineer now. That's probably what I would have been, because I would have never walked on and made it at Texas. My high school coach had just graduated the Citadel, and I had gotten an engineering scholarship to go to the Citadel. And he took me down, showed me around, met the coach. This is in June or July after my senior year of high school, which just shows you where recruiting is these days. And I made a decision to go. I didn't put a lot of thought probably into it. And if I could have gone home after week one or two, I would have, but I couldn't get in touch with my parents on the phone. So I just wasn't into the military and everything else. And as we fought through it, you know, Citadel, it did so many great things for me in my career. I'm not here today without the Citadel. It's organization, it's toughness. But you know, I was just blessed. It was my friendships. It was the guys around me. And I know everybody goes to college and has that. Luckily for me, I ended up with great, you know, Dan McDonald was one of my roommates. He's the head coach at Louisville. Tony Skoll is the head coach at the Citadel now. And we had some other guys that went out and coached and did. But, you know, we have a group now, our text message group, a pals group. We call them pals. And you know, pals for life is what we talk about. And we you know, shoot texts or crack on each other. But that group of guys that I had, I had a bunch of guys at the World Series. We got on the field afterwards and after we'd won it. And just that's what I take out of the Citadel is that group of guys, that camaraderie with guys that, you know, for good and bad. Because this past year, I've said it, you know, here locally as we've talked, but it was the hardest year for me, probably personally, I've ever had. I lost my mom in the fall, and she was the rock of our family. And then she took care of my dad. My dad has dementia. So then I become my dad's caregiver for about 8 months in the house. And we finally were able to get him in a home and everything else, but it just hadn't been easy. And, you know, we're in the ninth inning and there's two outs. We're up 9-0. So you can at least take a little bit of a breather. And usually you don't get to do that. And my assistant coach who had been with me forever, awesome guy, Kyle Cheesebro, had lost his dad in the last year, you know, and I kind of turned to him and I made a comment. I said, well, I hope Big Cheese is what we called him and my mom are enjoying this view from heaven, you know, because we knew, you know, it was just a, and then boom, next pitch and we're dogpiling. So it was really a cool moment. But like I said, it's my biggest year professionally.
Yep.
Probably my worst year personally. And it's amazing how, you know, God puts all those pieces together for you. Because it's just, you know, so that was a really cool part of the year, I thought.
That's a really cool, you know, how did you go back to your Citadel playing days and then you go with Dan to Louisville, you're with him. And then you took your first head coach job at Indiana and then you walk into the legendary Mississippi State and it's yours. Did you feel prepared when you walked in, like, I know I'm the right guy to lead this, or were there a lot of doubts in the back of your mind? What would you say?
I would say there's doubts. There's nervousness. There's everything. Just being transparent, you know, between the lines and the baseball and the recruiting, there was a real confidence there. Mm-hmm. It's this job is more about a lot of other things than just, you know, it's the pressure of the situation here and the magnitude of the job here. I probably do less coaching now than I ever have in my career because, you know, but I have a bigger staff. I have an unbelievable staff, but mine's more the direction of the program and, you know, just keeping this, you know, keeping it moving in a forward direction in terms of all the stuff that goes, because it's speaking engagements, it's alumni, it's your big leaguers, it's playing in the SEC and, you know, our kids are used to it and we talk about it, you know, when we win, I mean, our fan base is unbelievable, but it's tough at times for a kid when he's struggling here or anything else, you know? So there's a little bit of everything that you have to get used to because it's like being a professional player in a lot of ways.
How do you keep growing as a leader? How do you keep pushing yourself? The baseball piece is what you know, but now you're having to do all these other things. How do you continue to grow in those things?
You know, it's other coaches. I don't want to say steal ideas, but I have a lot of coaches really close around me. We spend a lot of time talking. On our group list, we'll get videos or even my team meeting this week. I got different type of videos and different type of things you see. And I really try to put Dan McDonald, who I worked with at Louisville, to me is the best motivator that I'd been around. And he still motivates me now. And I'm not even in his program and I'm not even one of his players, but we just spend a lot of time talking and doing, and it could be, whatever it might be, but I feel like it's a big piece. And it's not just motivating to be a great player, to work hard. It's, our kids deal with so much in this day and age, being a great student, being a great friend, being, handling the pressures of life that we deal with now. And we spend a lot of time talking about taking my uniform off, leaving it in my locker. And when I walk out of this stadium, now I'm just a student here at Mississippi State, cause I don't want them to walk around with their identity being they need to get three hits every day or throw a shutout, And so, there's a lot of leadership pieces that, and I like to use clips, and I like to keep, for me, I got to keep them short. My guy's attention span's not real long. So it's 2 to 3 minutes, usually on a clip, and I'll show one a day, or I'll read from them. I have all my, they hate it when I pull my books out, but I'll read some stuff here and there and talk to them a little bit. But, I'm going to mess this quote up, but not all readers are leaders, but all leaders are readers.
That's exactly right. That, yep.
Because you're trying to just grasp more and understand. I was on the phone yesterday with a former national championship coach, a couple times, and picking his brain. How do you, you want to enjoy this, but you also know that you got a bullseye on your back and you got to get this team ready to go because this team didn't win a national championship. And so I spent a lot of time, I call coaches and I talk to coaches and, we have a big convention. I like to spend time talking to coaches there. So it's a little bit of everything, but it's something we are constantly working on.
Yeah. And you hit it. The heart and soul of that group last year graduated. They're gone. They've moved on. And now, so how do you as a coach create a winning culture amongst these new kids? I mean, you're not starting your first pitch. It's going to be in Omaha. It's going to be freezing cold somewhere in February. How do you begin to create that winning culture every year? Because every year you restart it. You don't get to keep kids for a life.
Every year. It's, you hope you have some pieces in your program that run through, right? That, the expectations that we play hard, the expectations that we work hard and do. And I'd like to think we're, a majority of our clubhouse is going to take the experiences from last year and we can move them into the next year. But this team is totally different than any other team ever. And so it's going to take us time. I keep telling them, because I think some of my older guys, they walk back in that locker room and it doesn't feel the same because last year was so magical, right? Yep. And but by the end of the year, you're going to have some of those same relationships, same feelings. And, we're going to have success and failure together. Because sometimes the biggest, you said it about coaching a little while ago, but as our ball club, some of our biggest growth is when we struggle, and we have to fight through the struggle together. It's nice when we win and everybody pats you on the back and you walk out and everybody goes to dinner. But during our struggles, we find out more about ourselves than anybody. I had a player really struggle last year early, and he ended up being one of the best players at the College World Series. And, I'm talking to his dad afterwards, and, Coach, he learned so much going through that. Nobody wants to go through the storm, right?
That's right.
We learn so much about ourselves, and as a team, we learn so much about our team.
You hit on it earlier. If I would have gone through this as a young coach, I would have probably yelled and screamed and tried to motivate them that way. What do you wish, knowing what you know now, and you're in the middle of your, we're about the same age. We're really in the prime of our lives, of course, is the way I'd like to look at it. I don't want to look at it on the back end. We're definitely in the prime. What do you wish every coach, young coach, knew now that you have learned looking back in the rearview mirror?
I had a Chris Burke played for, you know, Chris?
I do.
Chris Burke is an unbelievable. He was my, he ran our Bible study group when I was in Louisville, who's an awesome guy. But he's also a great player, works for ESPN now. And he worked with us. He became our life coach for a year at Louisville. And one of the things he told me, and it really hit me at that point in my career, never forget how hard this game is.
Mm.
You know, as a coach, it feels easy because we've seen it happen a bunch of times or whatever it is. And for these kids going through it for the first time, because I was, you know, coming from the Citadel was a little tougher place. I had been coached, you know, I played for a Hall of Fame coach in Chowport, but he was tough. It was the old hard school, mental tough. I mean, and it was tough. And so I came out of that kind of background and, you know, I probably, you know, as a young coach, you know, getting them to play free is something we talk about all the time here. And it's just hard to play free when you get jumped. And, you know, if I want to get on a guy or I have an issue with a guy, usually it's about going to class or doing something off the field, right? That's usually where you get me upset.
Yep.
But if I do anything and speak to a player, it's usually in my office one-on-one. And I've learned to be able to – sometimes I would just get mad on the field and you know, I look back and as a young coach, I shake my head now. But, you know, bringing a guy in and really challenge him here in my office, then, you know, try to do it as respectful as possible. So, but I think as a young coach, that's the – don't forget how hard this game is, especially the offensive side. You know,
oh gosh, isn't that the truth, man?
This game can beat you down, you know, really quick if you're not careful.
You know, it's funny. So I was at Liberty 87 to 91, and maybe during that time saw four or five guys over 90, maybe. And we played a pretty solid D1 schedule. We're independent. Now that's just average. I mean, you don't see that, you know, our guys would be late bullpen guys, all those guys. And it just gets – the kids just get better and better, don't they?
They're trained differently now. We had 15 guys hit 95 last year. How about that?
That's unbelievable.
It's just – now, we had – it's COVID year. You got more pitchers. You're dealing with other stuff. But it was pretty crazy how many – you know, how many guys throw. And it's just training these days. I mean, we got more training, how the body works, the weight room, the analytics of the world. I mean, they just – kids are trained so much differently than we were. You know, you'd pitch every 5 days and go run and come back and ice it and come back and do it again. So these kids they're in a lot better shape than we were back when we played.
Yeah, I hate to know what the pitch count numbers were back in those days, man. I don't even want to know.
Right?
I
don't even know if we kept them, you know.
No, gosh, no.
So just let them pitch until they get tired. But
that's exactly
there's
right.
Some guys here, you know, I talked to some of the older players here and, you know, they'd pitch a 7-inning game on Saturday, close the game in the midweek, and then pitch again the next weekend. And, you know, nowadays it's not, you know, which I think I have an unbelievable pitching coach, Scott Foxhall, and he's done a great job of, you know, we feel like we do a really good job with pitch counts. And we were able to – maybe one reason why our pitchers were fresh when we were in Omaha,
yeah,
you know, is they, you know, just being able to hold on to them a little longer.
If you could sit down with a high school parent, a young high school parent, and a young high school player, what advice would you give them that they may not want to hear, but they really, really need to hear?
You know, I think the biggest thing is, you know, because recruiting is so early right now and everybody's worried about exposure. You know, the really good player, you're going to get you. There's enough exposure now to be so dedicated to being a great player. And I think one of the biggest areas is the weight room right now. Because as we sit here and we look at guys, most of the guys you look at, they're physically better in some areas, you know, and sometimes we end up playing forever. And I don't mind multi-sport guys if you go and play. I like football because you run around the pads and your body gets a little stronger. But I, you know, I think we get so caught up in exposure that I want to be the best baseball player I can be. And even, you know, I tell our kids, even the young ones that commit to us, you know, this, you're not good enough for us yet. You have to, there's this piece of the great baseball player continues to get better. And you'll see guys plateau sometimes, and the guy that plateaus usually doesn't end up making it. And so there's got to be a real motivation. And moms and dads just enjoy it, right? I had a daughter who played high-level soccer, and it was the funnest time of my life being a fan. I enjoyed watching her more than my team now. Like it was just, you know, and there was stress, but, you know, being able to enjoy that and realize, you know, sometimes parents think they're worse in their kids' play.
Yep.
You know, it's coaches. Now, there's some great coaches who have sons who are great players. But most of us have just normal kids who like to play sports, and they're, you know, that expectation. A lot of times you see the baseball coaches, they play another sport because they don't want to be, you know, judged on it. Just, you know, we start this originally just to enjoy it and have fun, get exercise, right? So I think that's the hardest one for some parents because they want it. Sometimes they want it more than the kid themselves.
That happens many times. Yes. That happens many times.
Too.
Yeah. So you've mentioned your assistant coaches, and I think leadership is putting a great team around you. I mean, you said it, I coach less now than I probably ever have. And I've got to have people. How do you find, and how do you keep great teammate assistants, guys that are, you know, are doing more than just pouring in great information? How do you do that?
It's never easy. You know, 'cause there's two pieces of hiring an assistant coach. One, they have to really know the game. They got to make the players better. They have to be great coaches. But I was real intentional when I came here because I knew the pressure of being in a place like this, that I wanted to sort of surround myself with guys that I would enjoy coaching with, that I really trusted, you know, that you have a trust factor with, because just like the players I spoke about earlier, we're going to have our ups and downs. And in those downs, you want to have a group that, you know, hey, you know, put your head down and just work and we'll be all right. We'll move through this. And I have an unbelievable group. Like I said, Scott Foxhall, you know, great pitching coach, but also, you know, we had been together. I was at the Citadel. He was at the College of Charleston.
Oh.
And so we played against each other for like 3 or 4 years. And then we were recruiting coordinators. I was at the Citadel. He was at College of Charleston. So we had about a 15-year relationship. And I just felt like he was a very calming piece in there. Jake Gautreau, who's with me now, he's been the National Assistant Coach of the Year, one of the top assistants in the country. But and he's going to be a great head coach here very soon. But I do think we've been able to keep him because the continuity of our staff, the relationship of our staff. Eventually, a bigger job will pull you away, but we haven't lost him for average jobs because, you know, I think he enjoys being part of this. And he, you know, I let my guys coach and I let them have responsibility, you know, and we, you know, and we, I even say it, hey, if we don't agree, let's all get in a room and hash it out. And then when we walk out that door, you know, we have to all be on the same page at some point, you know? And so, and Kyle Cheeseborough, like I said, has been with me forever. So I've had a group, and when I say staff, I'm telling you three there, but I have another eight, that player development coach and the operations director and external operations director and weight room coach, you know, there's so many pieces at a place like this. It starts to feel like a football program.
Yeah.
You know? So we have, you know, because our resources here, we have so many different people working with our kids. So we meet every Monday morning and we try to get on the same page and have the same message every week.
You know, people think about college baseball and they think about you coaching third base and you have a first base coach and a hitting coach and maybe a pitching coach. And nobody realizes, I mean, you have a company that you lead and you're the CEO of that company and your board of directors are the Mississippi State Nation, IL State Nation, that all have opinions. How do you keep your focus on what your job is when you have a lot of noise? Because I'm sure when it's winning, it's a lot of pats on the back. And when you get run ruled twice, there's a lot of, man, coach, have you thought about, how do you keep your clarity as a leader during those seasons?
It's very simple. We just say, you know, we talk about it, put your head down and just work and let's be fundamental and let's practice and control what we can control. And, you know, in our world, you just don't want to make bad worse. We don't want to make a, you know, you could lose a weekend. You don't want to lose 3 weeks, and trying to minimize that and keeping our kids want to win more than anybody. So questioning the effort or whatever, sometimes you just get beat. And I think in our world, we, you know, trying to keep an upbeat, trying to keep everything going in the right direction. You know, I think that's a big piece of it. But the year before I got here, and there's Gary Henderson, who's now the head coach at Utah. Gary, you know, they lost a coach in the first weekend of the season. They may have been the worst team in the country for about a 3 or 4 week period. And they end up in the Final Four of the College World Series. And a lot of young players, a lot of players who I just coached for the last 3 years, you know. And Jake Gautreau, who was here at the time, said, you know, I said, how'd you get through it? You know, how did you go through all that, the criticism, the everything? And he said, you know, Gary just said, coach them. Just come every day and coach them. Don't judge them. You know, sometimes as a coach, like, oh, we stink, or oh, that kid can't play, or whatever. And being able to clear your head and walk to the ballpark and say, hey, let's coach them. And, you know, they talked about they would just introduce a new element every week. He said, we didn't even use it. You know, it may have been a funky bunt defense, but we just wanted them to come, have fun. And, you know, there's such a fine line between good and bad in this game.
Yep.
You know, the kids in a slump, I always tell them, you know, your good swing's just right here. It's just right beside you. If you can relax a little bit, you'll find it. but sometimes they can't find it because they're trying too hard. And I think as coaches, being able to take a little bit of that pressure off is huge. Because I still credit Gary Henderson, man. What he did here in that job in 18 has propelled this program forward and was part of our national championship this year. Because if he would have just gave up on the kids and complained about the kids and, you know, been that type of coach, then we don't win a national championship this year.
That's fantastic. You know, and you think about it, you didn't start the Mississippi State program. But the guy who is known as the guru of college baseball and wrote the baseball Bible, Ron Polk, you know, is sitting in the bleachers at your games. He's sitting in your office. Is it hard to lead as a leader with even in it wasn't like he coached Mississippi State last week. He's been gone for a while, but yet his shadow is so big. How was that as a leader to deal with, and how did you deal with that?
Well, he's also my neighbor too, so we've got to put that on there. We live about six houses from each
That's
other.
That's fantastic.
And, you know, his boss is John Cohen, who was the baseball coach here for 11 years, played here for Ron Polk. So we have such a group in there, and I look up in practice, and they're both sitting up there with notepads. And I'm like, man, I wonder what they're writing, Coach Polk is writing down. You know, it was one of my biggest concerns coming here. Not Coach Polk, more John Cohen. Like, do you want to, you know, you want to come in here and be in a program like that? And, you know, this type of program with the stress and the pressure, and then, you know, have people over you that really know the game and are brilliant at the game and did this for a long time. You know, I some of my other places, the ADs, they know sports, but they weren't into the details of baseball. And I'm being very transparent here. You know, John Cohen has been, it's been a blessing for me. Because first of all, my first year I would call him. I say, hey, I need the baseball coach. Put your baseball hat on. Tell me about playing here. Tell me about the SEC here. Tell me about, because in the SEC, not everybody's not selling the secrets. You know, we're all kind of competing against each other. And John was a huge resource for me. And I'll say this, and we haven't lost a lot since I've been here, but when we have a tough weekend, when we get 10-run rule twice, the first text message I've gotten was John Cohen. All right, it's all right. You guys are good. You guys will be okay. Like, it hasn't ever been a judgmental piece, which I, you know, that means a lot. When you
That's huge.
Also saying that, you know. So he's been, you know, great in that area. Now, Coach Polk, he's the man. He is the I have never been around anyone who has the passion for the game of baseball. The pureness of the game is Coach Polk. And he brings an unbelievable personality every day. He loves the kids. He's always joking and laughing and giving you a hard time. And same with me. There's not a day that goes by that he's not going to come in and try to jab at you a little bit in a fun way, you know. And he keeps it very light, you know, and just wants to be around the game and coach the game. And we're so lucky to have him here. Our fans, man, they love him. I mean, he is the best. And, you know, I joke when I was in school, I said it earlier, I was an engineering major for about 3 weeks. And I had to call my dad and I said, Dad, I don't want to be an electrical engineer. My dad was an electrical engineer. He graduated from Mississippi State.
That's amazing.
You know? And so, you know, what do you want to do? I said, I want to coach. And I could hear it on the other side of the phone. You know, he didn't want me to coach. And, you know, so I went from EE to PE real quick. And my professor, you know, we had a baseball class at the Citadel and the book was the Ron Polk playbook. That's right. I said, there's nowhere you could go that it was more applicable for me to study the Ron Polk playbook. And so he still has a couple thousand in his garage. They're still sold every day. It's amazing. And, but he's been a great, you know, recent, you know, he does my radio at night and, you know, for the games, which you'd think would be a little scary, but he tells me all the time, I've never questioned you yet. So he goes out to laugh. He said, one day I'm going to question you. I say, well, Coach, I appreciate that. Like I said, he's always giving you a hard time, but he is, I've never seen a coach. And man, I hope when I'm finished, his players respect and love him more than any coach I've ever been around. He writes them all their happy birthday cards. He reaches out to them. It's just such a relationship. And that's why our alumni base of baseball players is so tight here. Because of Coach.
That's exactly right. You know, I knew a kid that played for him at University of Georgia, and same thing. I mean, he just would die for the guy. Yeah. He said, oh, yeah. He said, we moved, and my letter he sent me, my card bounced back to him, and he's calling my parents to find out if I was okay. Was everything all right? Because the card came back. It's just, that's amazing. And I want to get into that a little bit. So coaching a player for 4 years is awesome, but that coaching, you're coaching more for the long term than you are the short term. What do you hope a young man who plays for you looks like 10, 15 years after he's done wearing one of your jerseys?
That's a really good question. Well, I hope he's successful in all areas of life, not just, not just professionally, no matter what it is, if he's an accountant or anything, but, you're hoping he's a strong father, you're hoping he's a strong husband. I don't want to say teammate, but teammate goes, whatever we go in life, we're a teammate to somebody, right? And part of it, I think that's one of the bigger things. In our program, we talk about punching the clock, being somebody who punches the clock. And, we wake up and we get after it. Our feet, we talk about our feet hitting the floor, man, when our feet hit the floor, about tacking the day. And those are some of the things that I hope they take and move on with them in terms of where they're at and what type of man they become. It's not who we play. Sometimes how we do things is more important than other things. And I think those are some of the bigger pieces. I'm at a point now in my career, like you said, we're in the best time of our life, but we got players who, in my world, players who are married, kids, divorces. Yep. Just anything you can imagine. I feel like I've had kids reach out to me over the years and just want to talk or touch base. And I've been blessed. It was funny when you win a national championship like we did, my Citadel guys, my Louisville guys, my Indiana guys, and my Mississippi State guys I've coached, just so many people reaching back to you, not just the players, but people around the programs. That was one of the cooler things, even though my phone, I couldn't answer everybody, it felt like. But those experiences over the years and how you're maybe a sounding board for them is pretty cool.
I know we were on another call together. Your faith is a big part of your journey. What role does your faith play, Coach, in making you the coach that you are and the leader and the husband and the father that you are? How does your faith play into that?
Well, I think it's what you lean into all the time. For me, you wake up and, you say your blessings every day. And I feel like, I'm so thankful for everything here and being able to, I guess it gives me a real humility. I don't ever take myself too serious, and bringing that faith to our group and our kids is an important part, and never pressured upon kids, but I want kids to know, and I tell them in our first couple meetings of, who I am and what I'm about. There's not a perfection here by any means. So I'm probably about as flawed as they can be. So I want our kids to understand that, but for me, it's a lot of peace that I deal with. I grew up in a very strong Catholic family. Like my mom and dad, when I come home for the holidays, our priest was at Thanksgiving dinner. And my mom and dad worked in the church all the time. My mom had been to the Vatican probably, more times than you can imagine. And, when I cleaned her poor house, I got rosaries everywhere. Right.
Wow.
So it was, that it's just always been there for me. It's always been a big part of our life. And it's a real connection, with our family. And it's been nice to see my daughter, my oldest daughter married her husband. They met in Young Life, so
that's
it was
awesome.
There's been so many positives because of our faith, and you feel like, everything's pushed in the right direction for you from above. So
that's awesome. As you look back on your journey, there'll be a day that you hang the hat up and you hang your turfs up and you move on to that next phase of whatever life has for you. How do you pray that players remember you? Is if they were on a podcast one day and I said, tell me about what it was like to pray for Coach Lemonis. I knew him a little bit from some calls. What was it like? How do you want to be remembered by those players?
Man, you're throwing some good ones at me today. So, fair and for me, I don't know if that makes, I want to feel like it's really hard right now. Cause I put up a lineup. I had 50 players on my team last year cause of COVID, and I put up a lineup of 9 guys. There was so much, I want to feel like our guys had a real relationship with me. Mm. And I think that's the biggest part. And he cared for me, not just because of what I could do for him, it wasn't just about, me getting three hits or winning a game for us. It was more about who I was and what my journey was. And, you know, I think some of those pieces are more important than just, hey, he taught me how to hit a ball. You know, like I think that the relationship side, and, you know, I also want them to think that this time of their life was the best time of their life. When I went to college, was the best time of life. I want it to be fun for them. Yeah, there's obviously, we got to work hard and there's stresses and everything else, but I wanted to look back and say, man, I really enjoyed that. Coach made it fun. Coach, you know, and we laugh and joke a lot. I'm probably a lot more laid back than other programs, but I'd like to think our kids, you know, enjoy playing here and it's fun for them, you know, and those are some of the bigger areas, but, you know, fair and having that relationship to where, you know, he knows a little bit more about me than just being my right fielder and what I could do for him in baseball. So